Good evening, everybody. Evening. Welcome to the Africa Center. You have entered the home of contemporary African culture. The Africa Center, I'm going to be brief because the board has cut my hourly rate. But the Africa Center has been a charity since 1964, championing the cause of Africa and its diaspora. It was based in Covent Garden, and contrary to what you've heard, it has lived on and it has born itself again in Southwark, which is the place where the Africa Center should be. Southwark is a borough with one of the largest African populations in the country. So yeah, there's a Southwark supporter there. So we're really thrilled to have you here. We want you to come back many times. I want to welcome the White Cube team. Irene, you and your team have been fantastic to work with. I want to welcome the Adeniyi-Jones family. Brilliant. I'm not going to say much about your son that I'm sure you don't already know. And I also want to thank the Africa Center's team as well that have done a great job here this evening just preparing this event. And you can see it's a full house, so Tunji, you have a way of drawing a crowd.
Thank you.
And Jareh, welcome back. It's fantastic to have you here. So I have a very crude pad, okay? So this pad will be passed around. And if you're feeling the Africa Center, you want to leave your details, just scribble your details here or in a book. And if you don't, we'll see you outside later on.
It's a pleasure to be speaking to Tunji today. And thank you all for coming as well. We've been having conversations on and off for about 4 years. I first met Tunji in New York in his studio to interview him, actually. For a publication, which never happened. So I was in this position of just sort of having an interview that wasn't published, but
we had a really engaging
conversation. We had a really engaging conversation that just didn't, I guess, have this life that you expected. But what's been really great was to sort of come back and reflect on that conversation a couple of years down the line, revisit that conversation and sort of expand from it. So this evening, Tunji in conversation with myself, of course. When we're sort of like thinking about what to discuss tonight, we're really just going through a journey of sort of stylistic connections that Tunji has had through artists and art movements, beginning with the Harlem Renaissance. We have in this slide Aaron Douglas, a pivotal figure from that movement, a time when African-American artists were really sort of thinking of ways to represent themselves for themselves through the visual arts. I guess my sort of conversation starter was that in terms of like your engagement with artists like Aaron Douglas from the Harlem Renaissance movement, this also sort of corresponds with a time where you left the UK to the US. And as we have all experienced, when we travel and we arrive in a different place, there's different histories that are outside of your own that you begin to engage with and shape the way you think about not just the self, but the world and how you move through the world. So I was just wondering if you could just speak to that moment of transition from the UK across the Atlantic to the US, and also why an artist like Aaron Douglas, in terms of his representation and the sort of socio-political in his work, you know, why there was a sort of interest and resonance in Aaron's work and the wider sort of context of the Harlem Renaissance. It's an essay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, so this is how, yeah, thank you so much. And thank you all for being here. This is a real honor and a treat. I was mostly also hoping to, through this process, give you all an insight into the things that are usually quite private for me, the images that I look at, the histories that I'm involved in, and what's presented is an amalgamation of all of these things, right? But even if we look at this image closely, I didn't know about Aaron Douglas when I first started making this series of work that has kind of expanded to where I'm at now. But maybe you can see through the foliage and the leaves, those are symbols and shapes that are in my paintings. So these are kind of ways that I've been thinking about expressing foliage, expressing space, before realizing that it was connected to quite an expansive history of doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. So these were conversations that I had when I was studying my master's at Yale, and faculty would come up and be like, well, have you looked at this person? Have you looked at that person? Purely on an aesthetic and kind of formal basis. And then, of course, being aligned with expression and representing the black body, it all kind of married nicely for me when I came across his work. So pieces like this were really influential because I can imagine that an artist like Aaron Douglas at the time was also trying to respond to a very classical way of representing the body through painting, like a classical European historical way of representing figures and painting figures in a very photorealist or kind of representational way, whereas the kind of stylistic flattening that happens through the silhouettes in Aaron Douglas's work just seemed really powerful to me. It seemed like a really powerful way to express the figure and the body and the form. And things just kind of took off from there, really. It kind of gave me license to maybe unlearn a few of the things. Yeah, exactly. It gave me license to maybe unlearn a few of the things that I had been focused and taught very specifically at the Ruskin, for example, like anatomically, we did very specific kind of drawing exercises, to then kind of see that you can have a very powerful rendition of a figure by reducing it in this way to just like the slit for the eyes, very like sharp, boxy shoulders. Like suddenly the dynamism that can be associated with a body and the stories that can be told can be done in specific ways that don't need to just be sort of painstakingly painting layers and layers of flesh, for example. So that was and still is something that has become very captivating about this work in this period of painting in American history and just kind of like black art in America and here and, you know, across the continent as well.
And I guess one thing that really strikes me about Aaron's work is also his use of color, mm-hmm. Because we've sort of taken this silhouette out of the context of the black and white where there's a flatness, but then there's also sort of a journey into gradation and different colors that we saw in yes. Into Bondage, The Toiler,
yes.
And then in works like Judgment Day, which is also, I mean, outside of like subject matter, in terms of like this study of color and composition, and bringing together ideas of, I guess, cubism and use of color, and then sort of African American identity through these figures that have a sort of very direct representation of blackness or the black body in them. It's also speaking to me as a way of sort of reclaiming or sort of breaking apart from Western art history in one's own way, which I see as something that also sort of reflects the way you approach the figure.
So
I was just wondering how sort of studies in color, how they were coming through and how you're approaching that when you're looking at works like Douglas's.
Yes.
Just that sort of...
It's a great point, I think, and the one Judgment Day just before, and this one actually too, give a really good example of how through simple tonal shifts where you're taking a gray and making it gradually closer to a kind of yellow or a green, you create kind of a sonic space, right? So this work kind of has a sound to it. Like the way that the color's moving gives like a sense of reverberation and vibration and kind of like a certain energy and charge, which then can completely be co-opted by these silhouettes, which you're imagining are kind of either galvanizing or moving or like working towards something, freedom and emancipation. But all through some color and tonal shifts, you kind of get this energy and this charge in the space. Even though the space is pictorially quite flat, these really subtle shifts that you're seeing give it so much dimension. And that's something that, yeah, I've been thinking about, that I still think about ways that you can work within a very refined palette, like a monochromatic palette. You know, I consider this to be a monochromatic piece, but there are so many different variations of those soft gray greens and almost some kind of yellows that allow it to have this depth to it. And yeah, being exposed to the history of this work and then thinking about not just Aaron, but perhaps like some of the writers that were involved too, and then the musicians all kind of add to this for me. And living in New York when I was coming across this work as well, you know, I just walk around and you get a sense that you can feel what's happening a bit more. If I'd have come across this work when I was still in London, it probably wouldn't have resonated quite as much, I think. I think a lot of this has also been the contextual clues that have added to me kind of thinking about this work and everything else that's happening, like around the Harlem Renaissance in this moment. But certainly those colors, like, yeah, help me think about ways that you can make the space sound, have like a sonic resonance to it.
And then, I guess with this image, and also the title, Aspects of Negro Life, the Negro in an African Setting, and I know I've sort of mentioned about this connecting African-American culture, like a hybridization of culture, actually, in the work of Douglas. Also the fact that he was working in the mural tradition. This is one of three murals that he did for the New York Public Library. But I was quite interested in this idea of where the mythological comes into it, actually.
Yeah.
The return of, I guess, one's, or trying to locate the body back to its origin, in a sense, and then where these two worlds come into conversation, actually, which I felt this mural was expressing. But I guess as somebody who's coming at the sort of history from a completely, from an outsider's perspective, how are you sort of negotiating this, just ideas around just sort of the folkloric from sort of Nigerian heritage, and then sort of engaging with that in the space of African-American culture and in relation to the dislocation that happened in that manner. When you look at a work like this, if there's sort of parallels in that sort of, I guess I'm thinking of the mythological as a place for resolving or finding one's idea of the self.
Yeah, it's a place of an attempt at resolving, but you end up just finding that it's so much more, and that the world is so much sort of broader than what you initially thought. And that's kind of the impression that I get from a work like this, where Aaron is definitely trying to think about, connect with a West African, East African, South African, just connect with the continent in this way through these visual cues. And I think that what's an interesting parallel, a parallel would be me traveling to America and sort of understanding how I both am and I'm not related to what's happening in that country. You know, I am the color of my skin, of course, but I'm not American. I don't share that history. So there are these moments of like fantasy and imagination that happen when I'm there, and projection onto me, and then what I project onto the world around me to kind of maybe assimilate and to localize myself. And so when I'm making the paintings that I make there, I think something similar is happening, whereby, well, something similar to what I'd imagine, like Aaron Douglas is thinking about trying to communicate with that sort of African background, the inheritance, that which is far away and that which you can't understand, but he can try and visually represent. And so I think that that is definitely something that happens in my work too, where I'm not necessarily speaking specifically about a reality that I know or understand, because I'm distant from so many things. So it's kind of this beautiful fantastical potential that happens where, and then of course then you could think about any folkloric history of just being that, as just being that to begin with, as any kind of oral history as being that anyway, like a story from someone to someone else, and the story changes over time. So I think that in a way, the search then becomes its own kind of very positive historical kind of journey that is similar to any other time when people travel and exchange information.
Because, I mean, what I just remembered that he was sort of, these figures in this work, he was actually studying Fang's masks.
Yeah.
That's where he sort of, that was like the sort of starting point.
And that gives him the eye.
Exactly.
Like my eyes, like
that was the starting point for his figures. But then also, I guess, really taking like aesthetics from Fang masks and then putting that onto a body Yeah, so it's just something that I just wanted to...
Because, like, what makes... Because if I look at a fang mask and I do something similar, it's like, well, I'm also not... We're not from those people either.
Of course,
but just because, okay, I'm Nigerian and he was American, but it's like, so we're both kind of looking at it from this distance.
Yeah.
You could argue that I have a certain closeness, but I also don't, you know, it's also a very, like, foreign concept to me visually. So we're both trying to process this information and then, like, reproduce it in a way that's, like... Even though we're sitting on different sides of cultural placement, mm-hmm. we're kind of like consuming it in the same way mm-hmm. and trying to understand the way we feel about, the image.
And then we sort of move into, I mean, this image is really compelling to me because, of course, there's this sort of Western history of silhouettes and their origin in France. And then we have a generation of artists in the Harlem Renaissance reinterpreting that through sort of visual language that is their own. I'm also just quite curious as to how you sort of approach the silhouette, not just in painting, but in literature and book covers. And just, I guess, also something really connecting the whole conversation is around movement and dance and movement of the body being a way to transcend these geographical and linguistic barriers that exist. So I don't know, maybe you just want to speak to that a bit, just the silhouette as a sort of reclaimed way of working, perhaps, with the body and just the possibilities that it affords.
Yeah, the silhouette, as I've come to understand it, increasingly just creates such an open space for any viewer to perhaps kind of like assume the position of what they're seeing. So you don't have a specific barrier, like a specific feature, like a nose bridge or a brow to let you know that this is a person that couldn't be you or something. There's just like a kind of way that you can enter the silhouette, I feel, that makes it a very universal tool to use. And as, of course, I move around and experience my blackness in different contexts, it becomes important to keep my work open. And although, of course, I'm always bringing my Yoruba into my work, it's also like I want everyone to feel like they can relate to the figures and characters in my work. And so that's how I feel about silhouettes like these. It just feels like so open and accessible to kind of any perspective, any origin, and any site of interest. And the movement, I mean, on a stylistic level, to me, it just comes down to the lines and kind of the curves and the way that if you're trying to show a shoulder, you kind of just focus on the curve of the shoulder and then it suggests that it's moving. And for an image that's very flat and static, it just has so much life and vibrancy. And I think, the line is what does that. And that's something that I look for with my own work, is kind of like a space of inspiration, is how to keep the line compelling and keep the line flowing and expressive. It's like, a piece like this is so expressive, but it's very minimal in what it's offering. And I just think, there are so many other things that go into making it quite maximalist, even though it's so minimal. And I like that tension, two colors.
A sort of good segue into sort of Charles Johnson's publication, Ebony and Topaz. It's really speaking about like how an image expresses so much more contextually as well. And I guess I was just quite interested in, of course, you're looking at sort of painterly traditions, but we also engage in with literature from this period as well, and poetry, and just this relationship between the text and the images, because I know that you're interested in sort of illustrations of publications and have looked at that as well as part of a wider practice. I'm just curious to know about your relationship to sort of text from this period, actually, in terms of how that was, in a way, sounding these images and figures that you were beginning to engage with at the time.
Yeah, there was a cover that I realized I
didn't put it in,
but...
also have this.
Yeah, this one's also fantastic, by The Black of the Berry by mm-hmm. Wallace Thurman, I believe. So I read that, but also the cover of that book has an image like this. It's mm-hmm. just the most striking black silhouette of a figure kind of bouncing within these parameters. And then you read the book and you understand the kind of historical context of blackness in New York at that time. And the image and the story just kind of get married together in this perfect way. So that's how I feel about these illustrations that I see. I did a bit of extra work, sort of research into Charles Cullen, and it's interesting. His illustrations just kind of ran out and died flat. Like mm. he stopped getting work, and he stopped being able to marry his incredible drawings with the text at the time. Mm. A lot of the writers and poets, like the poet in this case, County Cullen, ended up getting bigger gigs and getting like different artists. So this work specifically in the drawing before, a kind of the few and only of their kind that I can trace online. A part of me now wants to go on like a journey to find if there's like a deep archive of his sketches or something, because he, you know, wasn't able to illustrate any more work up to this point. But certainly the relationship between book cover, text from this period is just, you know, pretty mind-blowing to me and for me in terms of the expression and the kind of awareness of what's going on elsewhere with the modernism, and then also kind of like even like abstract art from Eastern Europe, like Russian kind of like Malevich, like black squares and stuff, like being kind of aware of the way that the silhouette and this kind of pure black representation was being used and just employing it to represent the figure and represent like expression and emancipation, and it's pretty incredible.
Nigerian modernism. there's quite a bit to like unpack here, because we sort of go from the 1920s, we begin in the 1920s, not that there's a timeline of how one's thoughts flow, but obviously come into this moment in the 1960s with a group of artists that you wrote about as a BA student? BA student, yeah, Ruskin, yeah. The Zareh Rebels, which people's, some of the members are well known, others not so well known, but Ben Enwonwu being a sort of prominent figure within that movement. And also just thinking about this, I guess, contestation of a Western artistic British colonial tradition, that generation of artists were, rebelling against in a way, and the kinds of imagery emerging for them. We see it's almost as if it's sort of this in-betweenness between figuration and abstraction and rethinking the silhouette form, which in my opinion Ben Enwonwu just took it to so many different levels, not just in drawing but in painting and sculpture as well. We sort of see this form sort of moving across his practice in really engaging ways. And you've mentioned in the past that in a way, when you were sort of writing about the artists, you were sort of more in the theoretical side of things. Yes. And then you've sort of come back to this work as a point of departure, close to your, you know, close to where, you know, your origin. So it would just be great to just hear a bit more about, and we've had these conversations around how we keep discovering figures within Nigerian modernism.
And the things we discover are actually closer.
Exactly, than anything else we're taught. Yeah. And just the sort of, I guess it also speaks to the kinds of like art educational systems that we went through.
Fun is to imagine that exactly that is what was happening here too, right?
Exactly, exactly.
And Enwonwu's sort of repertoire or ability to paint, the range is just, there was no limit. So this also represented a moment where he was unpacking those kinds of traditional European painting styles and representational tendencies to then make something that's like very expressive and fluid and dynamic. So it's the same then, you know, he was very well educated in the arts too. So it's like at a certain point he had to then go and seek out his own kind of way, like looking inward, looking back to see how he wanted to express the body and the form. And so that process being one that I went through as well, it was incredible to just see that there's such an expansive history of something similar happening of artists coming from Nigeria, understanding that there was an attention to trying to paint in a European fashion, a Western fashion, and then deciding, actually, no, I don't want to do that. But getting properly schooled in it first, mm-hmm. and getting, you know, the proper kind of practice, and then deciding that actually I want to lift some parts from here, take some parts from here, take the part that is just the main one from myself and from what's at home, and create an image that's entirely new and dynamic. So coming across Enwonwu's work has been really, really pivotal, because it's been such a kind of confirmation and point of just validation for all the things I've been feeling and the discoveries and the conversations that we've been having. Because even when we first met in 2018, I don't think I was as familiar with his work as I am now. I'd seen it, but I didn't see how I could relate to it in any way. So now, as the experiences build and I travel and I kind of learn more and more about Nigerian artists, it's kind of like, and I relate to them in a way where I can see that I'm also thinking about things that I imagine certain artists were thinking about at a point, you know, unpacking histories, unlearning things, relearning things. And yeah, he's just the guiding light, I think, at this point. Works like this on every level, be it a color palette, the blue and yellow, be it the composition, the way that the figure touches the top, the bottom, the edge, the way that the figure resembles almost a letter, a symbol, all of these things could then be tied into fabric, textile, printmaking, other forms of expression that are so tied to, you know, being West African, being Nigerian, are all present in one image. And of course, the silhouette that has a bit of shading on it, but it just feels like such a marriage of all the things we've been talking about. And
of course, he's referencing the negritude movement as well, which, you know, speaking to this Pan-African way of thinking, and just the ways in which there was so much exchange, yeah. you know, in terms of sort of an awareness for everything else, and particularly in this sort of West African, across the West African coast. It's really powerful, actually, Ben's work. And then from Ben, we go to Yusuf Grillo, who I think, and sort of going through the images that we'll look at, certainly this sort of, I guess, in this sort of synthesis of yeah. style and learning and unlearning, this sort of very focused way of representing everyday life.
Yeah.
Or even sort of reclaiming familiar scenes like the mother and child, and the Madonna and child with the baby, but then there's a...
and then the color.
Exactly, the color as well. And then there's a sort of traditional sculptural figure mm-hmm. being held as well. So just these sort of subtle, well, not so subtle actually, quite direct sort
quite
of
direct.
Reclamation of... I guess you can really see the unlearning in these kinds of works. Yeah, and also just the fact that Yusuf Grillo's palette was mostly in blues and purples as well.
Some greens, but mostly blue and purple.
Yeah, mostly blue and purple as well. I guess I'm just thinking about how you, when you sort of first encountered someone like Yusuf Grillo's work, what kinds of, sort of themes of the paintings resonated in terms mm-hmm. of, because I mean he's sort of depicting just
yeah.
really sort of everyday life.
Yeah.
Jesus on a black Jesus on a bicycle, you mm-hmm. know, love it. But also this sort of, I guess there's a sort of cubic figuration going on more prominently in his work, both in the figures and also how they are part of the. Context that they're cited within. Yeah, just be nice to hear.
I think so. Immediately, I was taken by the color in his work, the blues and the violets. And I think what I concluded also is that, because people ask me often, like, why these deep blues and violets? Like, where does it come from? Mm. Perhaps expecting like a very elaborate answer. I don't have one. You know, it's very sort of just. It's just an intuitive response to the palette I'm using. So seeing work like this that, like you're saying, is kind of just like the everyday, the representation of the everyday being charged so deeply with this palette, this kind of like magical realism of just like it's some people cycling around, but the color of their garments gives this just like deep, deep, rich, yes, exactly. It's kind of hard to give any other sort of overarching answer other than just kind of like the world around us and what we're seeing, and particularly here, like dealing with the skin and thinking about how light can affect our skin in different contexts, it just like seems so clear that that would be the impetus for a palette like that, you know? And yeah, similarly with the textile and everything, it just gave me some answers for questions, you know, that I've been having for myself, like why these blues, why these violets? Because it seems like it's a space that we can kind of step into and kind of inhabit and feel and kind of charge with emotion and feeling, and yeah, it's just the palette definitely with Yusuf's work.
That's quite interesting how you sort of draw on just thinking about textiles and a textiles history, because of course I'm sort of looking at this woman in blue work and also thinking about things like Adeniyi-Jones, mm-hmm. Ashoke, reverse dyeing, and just how that color palette just permeates different sort of, specifically Nigerian ways of painting and making textiles and working. Mm. So it's quite interesting to think of those relationships across different art forms.
Yeah. Of course, yeah, he also has stained glass work.
Yes.
Which I'd love to try and go see next time.
I haven't seen it. I haven't seen it in person.
I think the representation of skin and tone and melanin, essentially using these tones and kind of like, in this instance, it being quite light-filled and more of a lighter blue. But yeah, I look at his work and I think of an artist who's wanting to really, really express beauty in this way and consider the ways in which color can be used to push that and to kind of really champion that kind of beauty, you know, of the everyday that was just around him. He also, yeah, very, very dynamic.
Can go back to, no. And then we come to Clara Etso, mm-hmm. Ugbodaga-Ngu. Mm-hmm. I think it's really fascinating because she was an educator in the 1950s. She taught at mission schools. She's like the first Nigerian woman, first Nigerian actually, to teach in the Zaria faculty. And she taught a lot of the Zaria rebels, which OKK Bruce and Anabre Preya, Ben Enwonwu, Demas and Woko. And had also sort of been on this journey in here to the UK. She studied here, she had a solo exhibition in London, and then returned to Nigeria, deconstructing all of that actually. So in this work, Two Dances, you're not really sure why they're dancing, or you know what sort of, you know, is it a wedding? Is it a, you know, birthday? You know, what sort of celebration is going on? But I guess just this idea of also as well the figure emerging from this sort of geometric cubist.
Yeah.
So where does the figure, and you look at the hands as well, there's a sort of geometric shape to the angles of the body, but really sort of merging the figure into the body as a way of, I guess, reclaiming this space of sort of Western cubism, which is really fascinating.
Yeah.
But also the fact that she'd had such an impact on a generation of painters that when everybody speaks about the Zaire rebels, you know, people are familiar with them, but almost like the generation before, the person who came before as an educator gets sidelined in a sense, but it's also working at untangling these traditions of Western gaze onto figuration in Nigeria, really, in Nigerian modernism.
Right.
Yeah.
or like, what's the term, sort of ethnographic painting or something, the idea of painting the other in a very specific anthropological way that we would be seeing in history book, right? And so that would be what dances should look like or something. But then reclaiming that whilst also using, yeah, this very dynamic, geometric, frankly, that could also resemble textile way of representing figures in space. The image before as well, Yusuf Grillo, has a similar kind of feel. And yeah, I feel really good about sharing these kinds of ideas with you guys, because this is directly something that I'm thinking about in the studio now, where I'm thinking about new work. I'm like looking at artists like this and trying to understand perhaps ways in which they were trying to complicate the same things whilst staying true to the specific context that they were bringing and the specific kind of backgrounds they're bringing, where they're from, things like this. But, you know, really, when I look at this work and Clara's work as well, I just think like, wow, this is, I'm trying to take things to a place that's this dynamic and that's this kind of like, this kind of free of certain constraints also. And it's incredible to hear that, I mean, Jareh told me about Clara basically a week ago. So it's amazing to hear about the influence that she had on some of the artists that I now am knowing to grow and love as well. It's just this infinite pool of kind of what's the word? I don't know, resource or something. I just feel like I can learn so much from her work and from images like this.
Jimma Bola Akolo, who you told me about.
Yeah, it's a week ago. Like, yeah.
Who's still alive?
Yes.
Actually, still alive. And I mean, I guess Jimma was a bit of a breakaway because he left the Zaria Rebels and just sort of went on this individual journey. And sort of, I guess, less of a sort of collective, or left the collective and carved out an individual practice rooted in the Zaire Rebels, but then quite distinct from them as well. And I feel like what's, again, we sort of have this conversation with a figure and then sort of reclaiming this space of just what that representation means actually at the time for an artist like Jimma.
And also bringing
in 2003.
These kinds of the design in the back on the left and right being so also specific in this way and pulling from, you know, it could also be like a Harlequin palette, you know, there are so many other different, those color arrangements could be so specific in other ways too. So it feels like it's really forward-thinking image in this way that's bringing together so many different aspects, even what we've been discussing, so many different histories, and kind of like, it's a really narrative sort of heavy image as well. There's a story being told here too, and it's also this wonderful like abstract composition behind the figure and the expression on the face, which again, although isn't silhouetted, is reduced in this way. I was just taken by his work as soon as I saw it. I thought, wow. There's a lot to learn here.
I guess in a sense, it's also this way of an artist just sort of really probing the history of narrative paintings and making it one's own actually through the vernacular around you, the everyday. And this was something that Akolo, you know, he was sort of looking at different cultures within Nigeria, representing them. Right. Here we have a Hausa procession.
Right.
And really just, yeah, you know, as I said, just really sort of reclaiming the space within this history of narrative paintings, right? And here we're sort of then going into more of these abstracted silhouettes that we've spoken about in detail.
It's so cool because, you know, I remember my grandmother gave me a book with images, and they had like a sequence of images that were of Hausa processions, right? And I was looking at it and sort of like trying to think like, how would I make a painting of this? Or like, how would I make a drawing of this? How could I try and represent this thing which is so far away from me, so foreign to me in this way, but it's like I see that it's something I want to communicate visually. So that's a space of inaccessibility, and then I come across work like this, and I'm like, oh, okay, that's how you can represent it. Like, that's a way that you can formally kind of try and take this festive, colorful, bright, expressive house of possession thing that I've seen in pictures and I've heard about, and I get the essence of. But thinking about paint to canvas and kind of like a flat pictorial space, and you know, seeing something like this is so instructive in that way, in terms of like thinking about ways I can represent something that I feel means something to me and that I would like to share. So yeah, a piece like this is so instructive because yeah, I can see the images of the thing that he's trying to represent as well in my head, and I can see how he's ended up here, and it's just this fantastic kind of digestion and then presentation of an experience and like a cultural space. It's really cool. Yeah, this too.
And then we move into the contemporary. Yeah. I think this is, I mean, I guess also just because of the context that you live in America, and you're working with painting and figuration, and also just thinking about a generation of artists, contemporary artists.
Yeah.
I guess Kerry James Marshall is really appropriate to begin with, because from Kerry James Marshall, we can talk about so many different African-American artists that, you know, were sort of really staking a claim for a place within the history of portraiture, historical narrative paintings, but just Kerry James Marshall, just really a sort of collision of different pictorial languages.
Yes.
Into the work that he does.
And also there's such, I mean, yeah, that's well said. There's a self-awareness to his work that I really enjoy.
Mm.
And there's a tongue-in-cheek nature to how he's aware of the meaning of being a very successful black artist, like then to now to, and then having access to these histories like we're discussing now, and ways in which you can charge a pictorial space with that awareness. How you can put a character here and through a kind of look in the eye, kind of let you know that he knows that he's in on it and he knows what's going on. It's like there's this awareness to his work that I think is just so fantastic. And I didn't know about it until I moved to America, and it was quite, that was life-changing to say the least. And it's the expression, the eyes, and letting the viewer know that they're in on something, that you're communicating with them in a specific way, is something that I really take from his work as well. There's this like cheeky kind of self-awareness going on that I think is very relevant now too, as we see kind of like black art in America and across the world get this like incredible economic charge, right? It's kind of like being sure that, like, making sure everyone is aware that we're also aware of what's going on. That it's not something that's passive, you know. Yeah.
Is there anything else you wanted to? I mean, I guess with.
Is that? No, I think that's a good image to land on. Yeah.
I think we're.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Everybody.
Thank you, everyone.